Welcome in.
It's that time of the week again. Week eight is in the past, and we're getting ready to get into week nine. We have a special, special guest, the biggest of them all, Mr. Big Hi. Boy Anthony Koempel.
Hi.
And our co-host, Dylan Perrone.
What's up, boys?
We got a good one for you guys tonight. Clearly, there's a lot to talk about, and I think we're just going to jump right into it. Big, I'm going to give you the floor to lead the way.
Oh, man, I'm nervous.
I'll pull up the matchups after your spiel.
What did you say?
You can do your, you can have the floor, and then I'll pull up some matchups.
Sorry. Just want to say, as we all know, I retired from the league last season, and this was it was a pretty legitimate retirement till I was given an offer that I couldn't refuse to co-own a team with cutie Nick T, Nick Tits, as everyone else calls him. Honestly, I think things have been going really good for me, Nick. He's an extremely good co-owner. You know, I wouldn't want to co-own any other team besides with him. We talk about every day. We text about our team, about what we're going to do for the week. We always come up with a game plan. You know, it's, there's never one thing that is left unsaid that we aren't settled about before the game start at 1 o'clock on Sundays. There's really not much to say other than Nick is like a great co-owner and we cooperate really good. And that shows with our record as 5-3. It feels really good to be back in the win column. As you know, in the last 3-4 seasons since co-owning the team with Ant, we've both been hit with a curse, which Ant seems to still have. No, mine's still there with the injuries and stuff, but we seem to be looking good. I'm in a playoff spot right now, 5-3, but you know, I owe it to Nick. He's such a great co-manager and I couldn't be more thankful for him.
I agree. It's working out so far for you guys. I'm just happy to see you in the running again. So thank you, Nick T, for joining.
It's a great feeling. It's a great
Absolutely.
Feeling.
You know, I mean, going through the Jets, like we talked about, or Jets, going through the Giants every year for the last 8 years, and then having to deal with fantasy for the last 2 or 3, that can't be fun, you know?
No.
Anyone would want to quit.
It's terrible.
Anyone with the passion that we have would want to quit.
There was a point.
Unless you're Joey.
Where me and Nick were going through, like, the worst spot of our team where everyone was just getting injured, and we were, like, at an under 500 record, and I told him, I said, bro, listen, like, I'll hand the team off to you. Like, I don't want the curse to like fuck you over or anything. Like, the team is yours. Like, I'll go into the settings and I'll put you as the manager and I'll just leave it completely. I'll leave the league completely because I was getting fed up and he could probably vouch for me too. And then, you know, he told me like, no, bro, like we're in this together. We're going to do this together. Mm-hmm. And I was like, all right, like it made me come give me spirits. And that's when I'm back and we fought to 5-3. And again, I owe it all to him.
So talking on this topic, you seem to be kicking the spirit that's been following you forever. What about Anthony Castriciano, who seems to not be able to do that? Do you think he's still plagued, or what's the situation there?
I think that Ann is still plagued. You know, we get started off with Allen Robinson. The guy, he doesn't put up more than like 6 points a week. And don't get me wrong, Ant's a really good manager, but he didn't get a quarterback. He's been streaming quarterbacks for God knows how many weeks. I don't even know who his starting quarterback is this week or what he's been doing. But, yeah, I think Ann is still hit with that plague that we both had. And I think he has the worst end of it this year. What is he sitting in, 11th place? One ahead 11. Of Luke. He was like, yeah. So
is Kirk Cousins still in the starting spot? Which, yeah. I mean, up to last week, Kirk Cousins was doing pretty okay.
But Kirk Cousins probably his best option. Time, that's never good. Never good. But Ant's a really good manager, man. So it kind of sucks to see him all the way down there. I'm pushing for him. I hope he gets better, but time will tell. Time will tell.
Yeah, I agree. So I guess since we're on Cass's topic, we should probably just jump into his game first. So if you want to help me do this one, let's find it. So Cass played the number one team, the league leader, Junior Koempel. It was another blowout loss for Cass, another blowout win for Junior. Junior won 146-84 to 89-26. Dill already alluded that I don't think Cass has broke 100 points maybe 4 times this season, roughly. At least have about half. That's about 50%. So obviously you're not going to be winning much games with that. Junior's been an absolute machine with his team. His team just seems to be untouched, like unbreakable, although people in the NFL are dropping left and right, whether it's injury or DUIs or mental issues. I mean, you name it, people are just not playing. And seems to not affect Junior at all, other than Chris Carson, which he's hurt every year. So that's pretty much a guarantee. What do you think with Junior? And is it all luck?
I think any fantasy football success is luck. I mean, it's impossible to win a league without getting some luck. If anybody tells you it's all skill, they're lying to you. But the fact that he hasn't had to deal with any adversity is obviously huge. But I think you kind of have to credit him for some of the sleepers that he picked. He got Deebo Samuel super late, got Cooper Kupp pretty late. James Conner, I don't even know if he might have even wavered him. He got him so late. These are all like very Brandon Cooks he got late too. I mean, these are all like top players in their positions where he got rounds way, you know, to way behind where they're normally drafted. So I think you have to give him credit for that. I know in terms of preparation, he studied for this draft 1 hour before on the way to the draft. So it was actually recorded by Cast and sent in the Snap group for proof. So as far as preparation goes, that's it. I think, yeah, he hit on a lot of things. But I don't think we can give it credit at all to luck. I think he's done a good job this year. And I think he deserves some props because everyone shits on Junior most of the time, including myself. But no, I think he deserves some props. Big, this is your brother. Normally of the two of you, you're the one, to go to in terms of fantasy advice. Victorious in numerous leagues, including this one. But how would you rate your brother's success this year? I think from my standpoint, I have to give it up to him. But anything you could add?
Normally, like you said, we would all shit on him, but I got to give him credit where credit's due. They draft a really good team. I believe he got D-Hop in the second round. On the super round, which is really good. You know, me and Nick were deciding between him and Calvin Ridley, and we went with Ridley, and we all see when that happens. That was a good pick for Junior. Cooper Kupp, you know, nobody expect him to have the year he's having. Deebo Samuel too, like, you know, we all thought like it was Brandon Ayuk's time in San Fran, but you know, it was complete 360. I feel like a lot of people also stayed away from Brandon Cooks because of the whole Houston Texans situation without Deshaun Watson, but Junior took the gamble and took him, and it's paying off. The dude gets like maybe like 13 targets a game, which is really good. So I got to give Junior credit. You know, he deserves this. 7-1 looks really good on him. I'm happy for him. He did good.
I'd have to agree. Do you want to go into the matchup just a little bit? And then we can move on to the next one.
Yeah, we don't have to. Yeah, do the key ones. Do yours, do Biggs, and do mine. The other ones kind of speak for itself. One thing I just want to touch on before we skip over. We were supposed to have Weezer on tonight. We'll try to have him on next week. Part of the reason I wanted to have him on is because he probably had the biggest upset of the week versus a very upward trending Luka Duccio, and Weezer is definitely on the down. Yeah, look, most points scored this week. Wow, even more than Junior. So I think this, you know, a lot of people didn't see this one coming. So just shout out to him. I know he would like to be here to touch on it, but he was at the Rebel game, so that's okay. The show must go on. We'll have him on next week. But big, big bounce back week for him, especially without Kareem Hunt too. Shout out Weezer because it looked like he was trending downward and Luke was there. We're going in opposite directions.
Yeah, I think his team's on the trend up. I think the Eckler, his team goes kind of as Eckler goes. So, I said the two. I said Eckler and Cooper last week, and that seems to be the case. If we can get Hunt back and rolling, that'd be nice. He's in Cass's situation with the QB1 though. I think he's already looking for one right now, but if he can get a QB1 that can have some more consistency, he'll be more than fine. So he's just got to string some wins together. Luka Duccio, tough loss, but he was on a big winning streak, if I'm not mistaken. So he'll bounce back right away.
He won three or four in a row.
The Gainwell is the big thing there. It's like I think we all expected a little more from Gainwell. The guy, like, he played less when Sanders wasn't there, which makes no sense at all, but that's the Eagles for you. Literally makes no sense. Devontae Booker stepped up though. He's been pretty solid. I'd like to see that. And then, so Dill, you were one of the probably the highlight of the week because of the way the game finished. It literally won by 0.04 points. I'm not sure how. Yeah. I still don't understand how this the points like the point zero whatever is work because that's not even a full yard, right?
Yeah, because the it's because of the quarterbacks. Because when QBs throw, like if a QB throw for a QB, 1 point is 25 yards. Instead of for a receiver or a running back, where it's the flat 10 yards is 1 point. So it's divided by 25 technically per one, if you wanted to do the math. And obviously, you could see how Kyler Murray got him the 0.06. Just for anyone that was wondering about the math, it's kind of it makes sense if you think about it. Nevertheless, Big and I watched this together. Junior almost jinxed my demise. but we pulled it out, man. Honestly, I got to credit myself. I haven't been having a good season, but I got to pat myself on the back for this one. I mean, if you look at my bench, it was just the adversity is an understatement. No Devontae Adams gets COVID. No Calvin Ridley decides he's depressed, doesn't want to play football. Michael Thomas now out for the year. No Dawson Knox. Miles Sanders out for 3 weeks. I mean, these are guys that either just picked up or just traded for. It's just started getting hot. So, like, God, I was dealing with a mountain of headaches. But I think I want to pat myself on the back for the Jamison Crowder plug and play. I picked him up because I figured Mike White, new quarterback, they'll probably be checking down a lot. I don't see him going downfield. And Jamison Crowder has been the check down king for probably like 8 years now. Pulled it out. And this was a huge, huge win for me. I texted you, Baby Sal, like the difference between 3-5 and 4-4 is huge. I'm actually in fifth place now. I think I passed you in the standings. And I'm one win away from the third seed, realistically, which is crazy considering if he had gotten – Darrell Williams had gotten one less yard, I'd be one or two losses away from last place. So these are the games that you got to pull out. I feel like everyone – kind of had one of these gutsy, gritty wins besides me. Usually, like the low scoring ones kind of tend to not go away, but it was nice to pull one of these out.
It's important. It's actually crucial. So at this point, every win counts, but
yep,
you got to win these kind of games, especially in the middle of the season. So
this was also a team I was kind of competing with. They're close with me in the standings, so I was kind of able to get one up on them, which is good. Because not to say like anyone's not important, but like if I would have beaten like a Luke Liguori, or like or a Junior, or someone who's clear in front or clear behind, it doesn't really shift the standings that much. But this pushed me a game ahead of them, which is huge because
it almost made it like an early playoff game.
Yeah. This was. I mean, we were one spot. I think they were actually one spot above me as of last week, or we were tied
for six.
Yeah, I think we were tied last week, and now if you look, they're in 10th, and I'm in 5th, and that's all because of 1 yard. So that kind of just literally kind of just shows it. But yeah, I like Tuch and Danny as managers as well. They've also been hit with like serious injury bugs that no one really talks about. Like obviously, everyone knows about the McCaffrey thing. But yeah, I know they've been like streaming tight ends for a little while. Kyler Murray did not look good.
Kyler is a bigger concern now.
Yeah, I know he got hurt his shoulder. Didn't look good that game. Now to think of it, if he doesn't throw that pick at the end, they also probably win because that's what minus a point for the interception.
Yeah.
So a lot of crazy things. AJ Brown is obviously the
bell cow.
Yeah, that's the hot point in their offense right now. Especially the fact that Derrick Henry just went down, which we'll touch on a little bit later. And Julio Jones is never healthy. So it looks like this is literally the guy that's going to be producing points for them. But shout out to them for the Herbert and Mitchell pickups.
Yeah, they finally found their RB2 when they haven't had their RB1, which is
great. Yeah, for somebody that, you know, was struggling with running backs, the fact that they were able to pick those two up is good. They're smart guys that work the waiver wire. Yeah, McKissick too. I know that you're a Gibson owner and you're probably questioning his future, but McKissick is always a dump-off king, so for PPR leagues, exactly, they can be throwing him. And they also had no Josh Jacob this week, so I know I had injuries and I complained a little bit, but they didn't have Josh Jacobs or Christian McCaffrey, so they didn't have their RB1 or their RB2. So they ended up throwing their RB3 and RB4 into their RB1 and RB2 spots and almost pulled out a win. So got to give credit to them. It was a hard-fought battle, but that's all I got on this game.
Look how important it is to get catches as a running back, though. This guy had 8 receptions for 10 yards. I mean, that's half his points right there.
Yep.
So Magic actually did something with that. I think what's alarming, though, is like someone like a Devontae Smith. Your team wins 44-6 against the worst team in the league, and you put up one catch for 15 yards as RB1. You know, that's pretty alarming for him going forward. I mean, he's been struggling in general lately, right? Like pretty bad those.
Honestly, dude, I've been saying this all season. Big will tell you this because he's a former Miles Sanders owner. There's no consistency in that Eagles offense. It's one of those offenses that you really don't want to have a part of, unless I guess you're streaming Jalen Hurts, who's okay. But there's not really a consistent player. Honestly, the most consistent player might be like Dallas Goedert or something, but there's no receiver. There's not really a true wide receiver one in that team. I guess talent wise, you'd probably say Devontae Smith, but I mean, would he catch one ball? The running backs, even when Miles Sanders was healthy, was a shit show. It's one of those offenses you probably would stay away from.
Good boy, yeah. Fantasy.
Yeah, so, I mean, if I were them, I'd probably start Allen and A.J. Brown and maybe flex Sutton and then flex one of the other running backs. Flex
McKissick, yeah.
Yeah, flex McKissick going forward. Something along those lines. And then I know McCaffrey's supposed to be coming back this week or next week, so hopefully they'll get some consistency. But obviously they're in a little bit of a hole being 3-5 now.
Might have looked for a quarterback in the meantime as well.
Yeah, if Kyler doesn't play, that's another. It's funny that quarterbacks isn't usually like a scarce thing. But this year, probably like the more noticeable ones in fantasy where people are kind of like lacking a QB. Like normally there's a lot of good ones on the wire. Seems like there's kind of like a drop off this year. Like I know Weezer's struggling, Cass is struggling, and then talking about these guys. I know Luke Liguori just lost Aaron Rodgers. Finally, someone that I traded away that decides to not play. So now I don't feel as bad that it happened to me, but.
So before we move on, you want to touch on your trade real quick? But should be going through by tomorrow.
Yeah, so I traded McLaurin and Singletary for Adam Thielen. If you look at the points, McLaurin and Thielen are like pretty much identical. Reason I did it is because I wasn't sure about Davante Adams' status. As if he was going to play this week. I forgot I put Robbie Anderson in there. Honestly, I was considering dropping him. I threw him in. The Don could do whatever he wants to do. But Terry and like I was saying, Terry and Thielen are pretty much identical. I think Thielen might have like 3 more points in him or something. I know Don just lost Derrick Henry, and he doesn't have the backup for him. So Singletary, although he's kind of inconsistent, he's at least a starter you might be able to plug in. And like I said, I was concerned about Adams' health, and the Redskins are on bye this week. So if I didn't have Adams again and now Ridley quit football, I needed someone to play because I would literally only have Jameson Crowder as my only healthy receiver, and I literally have to start 2 receivers. I don't have a choice. So it's kind of like just playing that type of game where it's becoming a point where my bench is so falling apart that I need to field a lineup week by week and just kind of play the bye weeks. This is where we talked about earlier, Sal, in the previous podcast, about people that really stack their benches once injuries and bye weeks start occurring and who can kind of prevail. For me, I think on paper, my bench looks super stacked if you read out their names, but none of them are playing. So that's fantasy for you, and I had to make a move. But I think realistically, it's kind of receiver for receiver, and Don's getting a running back he could plug in for the time being. I mean, at least Singletary's in a high-powered offense. He's not the greatest, but he's playable.
I'll tell you what. If Robbie Anderson has a chance to go off, it might be this week, because New England likes to take away the wide receiver one, like more than any other team in this league or in the NFL.
Yeah.
So maybe there's a chance where he can actually get targets and start catching balls, but – I know he took a big hit last week. I don't know if you guys saw that.
Yeah, he did. He ate it, though.
Dude, and then he got up and played. He's not even questionable.
Yeah, he's a beast.
However, the punter, what team was it? Oh, the Steelers punter. No, the Steelers kicker. Dude, Boswell? He got sent into a different dimension, dude.
Saw that.
Anyway, I like the trade. I was trying to do the same thing with Gibson. Obviously, same team, both on a bye. Gibson hasn't been performing like McLaurin, but I had the same idea you did. I just didn't get it done. Anyway, another team that who's also part of this trade and who's also fighting in that realm with me, you, Nick, and Tooch for that sixth spot, really. We'll just talk about it as a sixth spot. Like to get into the playoffs. Well, fifth and sixth. So, and then Chris is now in that conversation. So is Weezer. Is Anthony Donahue, who's had a great season, great draft. Everything has gone his way. Literally everything has gone his way. He's made some moves. I mean, he's got four roster moves. He's got a trade with you, which is possibly his first trade ever. Wasn't his name last year was no trades, right?
Or the decline trades. I think he tried to make
decline
one.
Trades.
It tried to make one, didn't go through.
So the guys went from conservative to at least opening up to becoming a little more progressive, and he's just getting involved. He absolutely loves everything about the league and fantasy football. He's a totally different fantasy manager than a couple years ago. It's not even close. He's only getting better. And then this happens, right? I mean, yep. If anyone knows this better, it's probably Anthony Koempel, big boy, but maybe he could touch on this big blow that he took.
Well, first off, if you looked at Don's thing and you've seen his waiver moves, he only has four. That's one area Don could, like, get a gimme up in because, you know, you don't win by the team you draft. You win by working the waiver wire.
Honestly, four more than he had last year, probably.
Yeah, well, you're definitely right. And I know Chris mentioned something in the chat, like, why didn't he try going for Nicholson or AP? And Don said he didn't even look. So, honestly, it comes down to lack of awareness for Don and lack of, you know, if he really cares. But taking that hit with Derrick Henry, it's tough. I mean, I took that same hit in one of my leagues with him this year. So, I kind of feel for Don. I've been going through it for, like, the last 3-4 years with fantasy. And I even lost, you know, Montgomery earlier this season. But for Don, like, he ought to sell me see his bench really quick. I don't really think he has a good backup running back anywhere that he could, like, plug in for that. But
Hilaire, but he's gone.
Sony Michelle. But
well, Spope is running backs now.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hilaire's injured. I have Hilaire's backup.
You know, Don has to have that awareness to either draft the backups or, you know, pick them up off of waivers or just work that waiver wire. That's how you're going to lose the league.
Did you get the quote from earlier
shot.
From him?
Don had a good shot, but now I feel like he blew it.
What was that?
Did you get his quote from earlier today about why he didn't pick up Adrian Peterson and or McNichols?
Yeah, no, he said it in the chat. It basically what Big said. He just said he didn't look, which is, you know, when you see your running back get down, I mean – I don't know how to say it. You should probably look. I don't know what else to say.
You know, what Don could do is use Joe Burrow as trade bait and trade for, like,
yeah, I know people are looking for running backs. Looking for quarterbacks.
Cass is looking to deal Zeke. That might be a good move.
And then Sal also need a quarterback, too, because he's, like, in a tough situation. But, you know, one of those two, Ann or Sal, he could.
And Nick and Tooch in the meantime.
Yeah.
Murray misses any time.
Yeah, Burrow's been really good. I think he kind of needs him this week because all the Buccaneers are on bye.
Yeah.
But other than that, he normally starts Brady. So, I mean, I guess after this, he could start looking if he makes it through this week. I'm not sure who he plays against, but he's definitely got something to work with here because his biggest players are on bye.
Yeah, Don had a shot, man. He really did.
Yeah, like this was definitely the best team he drafted on paper for sure.
Yeah, it could have been his first fucking playoff appearance, and now Derek Kearney goes down, and he's just like backup running backs are just not going to do it.
Yeah, this is where I think he kind of fumbled the later end of the draft of it.
Yeah.
To where it's just like he kind of didn't know any of the players left, and he was kind of checked out and just ready to go home. You don't think that your stars are going to get injured, but if they do, this is where kind of the late round guys come into play, and sadly, it's not hitting for him.
Big, obviously, you played him. And you got the victory. It wasn't the biggest point scored of a victory for the two people, but do you blame it on Henry? Like, is Henry the reason you got the win? Kyle Pitts? I mean, what really went wrong here?
I mean,
or went right for you?
What went right for us is
Lockett decided to play.
Lockett decided to play.
Yeah, that's the big thing I see.
Odell screwed us, Nick Chubb screwed us. You know, it felt like fucking Dearness Johnson or whoever, one of the Johnsons. In that backfield was getting more carries than Chubb. I know me and Nick were texting. Chubb didn't get any goal line carries. It was all the backup running backs, and that's something frustrating to really see. Chuba really stepped up for us again. Waddle didn't put up the numbers that he normally puts up, but he did get the targets. But honestly, that Derrick Henry going down was a huge benefactor in our win.
What's the Chuba backup plan if it's, say, one more week or maybe two?
If McCaffrey's not starting?
Well, McCaffrey comes back, say, next week or the week after, worst case or best case for you.
We'll probably start Chuba this week if McCaffrey's not there. But if he's there, you know, we're just going to bench Chuba because, you know, McCaffrey's going to get all the touches since he's back.
Monty coming back soon, though, right? It might work out timing wise.
Might work out perfectly. Yeah.
Monty's coming back.
They have a bye week next week, so I feel like they're not
week 11.
Yeah, they're probably sitting through the bye, and then you'll probably get them after that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For them, we also just pulled up Nicholson too, so we're hoping he could get like a little PPR running back action going because he's more of like the catching back kind of. And having Montgomery back would be huge, but we're also trying to deal him for another wide receiver when he comes back, but no one's biting. So honestly, we might just hold on to Montgomery, but
just such a risk right now. It's hard.
Yeah.
I know we're trying to get a deal done, but it just also doesn't work out with us.
Yeah.
We're both in the same situation.
Exactly. So honestly, you know, we'll have Nick Chubb, Jonathan Taylor, and Montgomery back. You know, we'll have that three running back set. And then now with Odell situation going on, which I don't know what's going on with that. But me and Nick kind of declared.
We'll get into that.
Receiver. So we kind of just have to worry about a flex now. Because Waddle's
about Agnew. I thought this was a great pickup. And still,
yeah, that's all Nick. That was all Nick. That was a huge pickup by Nick.
His target, look at this. He didn't put up the best performance for, like, he got in the end zone. But
his targets.
The 12 targets jump out, and it's been solid.
Yeah, that's all Nick. That's a huge pickup by Nick.
The downfall is the team. Yeah, that's really what hurts anyone.
Bateman looks like he's getting a little bit more progression in that Ravens offense.
Look out for Bateman this week.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't think you have much of a choice, but.
Yeah,
when I Bateman's the guy this week.
Like, I was just telling you on the phone, like, I feel like Odell was a must-start because.
Yeah, you know, we'll get to the Odell stuff very soon. We have so much. The amount of stuff that we have to cover this week is ridiculous. I don't know. This NFL's falling apart. So we had the rematch, the Super Bowl contenders last 2 years of me and Joey. This time, I didn't even pass 100 points. But Joey actually probably had his lowest scoring week of yet, so. Maybe Joey was exposed. I mean, Mahomes didn't go down this time. I just don't think the Chiefs are doing as good as they can or they should be. So is this like kind of a weakness for Joey? Are we seeing like a chance to beat him? I know Dill took him out.
The Chiefs tell all. If the Chiefs aren't on, he's going to lose. I mean, this was a weak week for him. He got away with it, honestly, because you put up a stinker. But the Joey's team is, he's human. He's showed to be beatable. He's not the biggest threat in the league anymore. Junior's team is, just because it's more consistent. Mahomes has not looked good. The Chiefs as a whole have not looked good. They barely beat the Giants, who are sorry. If the Chiefs aren't rolling, he's not going to roll. I mean, Travis Kelce, that's a terrible game from him. Obviously 17 points is not good for Mahomes at all, comparing where he drafted him. I mean, I guess Hill kind of saved them, but other than that, I mean, if, like I said, if the Chiefs' offense isn't rolling, he's not going to roll.
Let me see. Well, Patterson and Henderson still look awesome. I guess that's some silver lining.
How did Patterson get 18 points? That doesn't make sense.
There's a lot of balls.
He got in the end zone. I know that. They catch those 5 balls, get in the end zone. Sometimes it's all it takes, literally. Michael Carter jumps out to me. I've been trying to acquire him via trade. I'm not sure if Joey will ever start him, but. Yeah, I was trying to acquire him with Michael Carter just to get a receiver out of the deal, but
yeah,
we'll see. I guess for me, and we're going to save a lot of this information after the matchups, but maybe Byron Edwards gets a chance to shine. I think the guy's got the talent, just not the target share. With the rug situation, maybe he can step up for me because I need someone else to step up for my flex and my depth, especially with Gibson out. The good news for me after this week, not only have I gotten past playing Junior and Joey, after Gibson's bye, I have, like, literally other than Jamar Chase, everyone has been on a bye. So I can definitely kind of – it's kind of like downhill from here, you know? And I'm still at 4-4. That's why I said this, like, 3 weeks ago. I had to get the 4-2. I actually expected to end up at 4-4. Like, obviously, I played devil's advocate. I didn't think I'd put 86 fucking points up. I actually probably should have won this game. But I'm not terribly upset with where I'm at. I'm still in the playoffs as we speak. So, but for me, this is becoming like a win at all costs kind of week already. So, and it is
really so normally you're like up there in the standings, like every year, like you're the first place guy, second place guy. Yeah. But this year it's like different.
Yeah, I'm still in the contention. I'm slipping, and then I'm gaining, and then you know.
Yeah.
But this is a big week for me and Nick and Tooch. So I think this is one of the matchups of the week, personally, since we're kind of in that – we're getting in that point where we got to find the separation. So I just wanted to allude to that. Obviously, the biggest matchup of the week is I mean, it's obviously huge. Joey versus Junior.
Look at those Nobody projections.
Nobody can avoid that weekend. It's crazy. And the projections are right. The projections are normally right with them.
Yeah, I mean, those are definitely the two top dogs. This is a
heavyweight bout, bro. Yeah, if we're the whatever you say it, they're definitely the heavyweight. But welterweight.
Yeah, this is a heavyweight title fight right here. This could very well be a Super Bowl preview.
Although Junior, they are pretty much both heavyweights, so it makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, this is gonna be a battle. If I were Joey, I'd probably flex Michael Carter, to be honest.
We were just talking about Michael Carter because I've been trying to acquire him.
Honestly, Mike White looked okay, and he looked like he looked to dump it off a lot. And in PPR, dump off guys are the best.
That's what I'm telling Joey. He's not gonna to him. Michael Carter is his fourth running back, which is fucking ludicrous. But
yeah, I'd probably play him over Jacoby Meyer just because the Patriots' offense is kind of unpredictable. And I think
I was say, where's Joey and Jacoby Myers? Is he like?
Yeah, he likes him. He plays him a lot. I don't know. But honestly, I'd consider even starting Carter over Zach Moss.
You think Joey's just frozen in, like, I'm doing so well and I rely on my Chiefs. He doesn't have to do any managing. He just starts his team every week.
I don't know. I stopped questioning Joey a long time ago. he's still in the top spot. So if you're asking me to explain his logic, I have no idea.
In the Gronk like movie did 1 week. He hasn't really done it.
Nevertheless, like, his team is really good still. I know that he has his mainly has the Chiefs. Too. Yeah, he mainly has the Chiefs, but he's got other supporting cast. I mean, Patterson and Henderson are beasts. Mike Williams is a beast. Van Jefferson is a viable starter. Now DeSean Jackson is off the team, so it even makes him more viable. If you let me see Van Jefferson's stats for the last couple weeks. Yeah, not terrible. Yeah, been more involved these past 2 weeks. He's gonna get more involved without DeSean Jackson too. So it's really just the three-headed monster of receivers and if Matt Stafford's playing at MVP level, so I'd want any piece of that offense if I could. And this is a heavyweight title fight. I think I'm gonna have to pick Junior in this one, just because of the way the Chiefs have kind of been playing recently. Like, I kind of have to see them get back on track to believe it. Mahomes is going up against a Rodgers-less Packers, though, so that means the Chiefs might have the ball a lot. So if they're gonna bounce back, I think it's this week. But I think I'm going to rock with Junior. I think he's been the more consistent team. He's been putting up the higher numbers overall. And if I had to guess, I'd bet Junior. But this is a matchup that definitely is the matchup of the week.
Oh, yeah. Big time. What do you have winning this one, Big?
So here's the thing. You guys know how I feel about Joey's team. I'm going to go with Junior too on this one, just because, you know, the Chiefs have proved to not be so good the last couple weeks. And I do understand that they're going against Green Bay, who does not have an Aaron Rodgers, but I think that, you know, the Chiefs have been struggling. They barely beat a Giants team. So, you know, I have Junior coming out in this one, and I'm not trying to jinx him, but I feel like Junior has a better team. I feel like the Packers are going to run heavy Sunday because, you know, Jordan Love, I just don't think he's ready for the big time. So I feel like they're going to run the ball a lot with A.J. Dillon and Aaron Jones. So I feel like Junior's going to edge this one out. And, of course, Deebo Samuel Brandon Cooks is going against Miami. Mark Andrews, Minnesota. So I feel like he has a good matchups this week. So I think Junior's going to win this one.
I think, yeah, most people are going to have to just go with Junior this week. I don't think you can bet against the dog, though. That's my only problem. So he proves it when it's time, and this might be his week to step up again and reclaim his throne. He's not going to give it up, I know that. And I'm not sure if anyone really knows how to beat him. I tell you, I can't. So I just can't figure it out anymore. So it's probably why this is the last season you'll ever see us. This is the last year doing the podcast together. We'll probably be done with fantasy for the rest of our lives. This is Joey.
So. I think it's all luck. I'll be honest.
Yeah.
That is all luck.
I mean, we still have to address how he got the three of them in the draft, but that's a whole nother podcast for itself.
All he did was he threw up a Hail Mary, and they fucking caught it, and that's why it seems 7-1. No disrespect to Joey. It's just he landed three Chiefs players, bro.
Yeah, I know. Definitely the game we're going to be looking at, though. And then you have one more game, which we can just touch on real quick since we pretty much went through them all, which was the worst game of the week, you know, based off of standings and probably score as well. But you had Chris Kamaru beating Luke 118-108. Big win for Chris, though. Obviously, they both needed the win. They lost, you know, according to Luke Liggs, though, he needed to win more than Chris needed to win. That's the quote we got in, if I'm not mistaken, Dylan. I know you're a quote guy. But I think word for word was, I need this win more. And then Chris. Good.
Well, I mean, just for the simple fact that Luke only has one win, I guess he does. But I think his playoff hopes kind of went down the drain a while ago, where Chris is obviously fighting for contention. So I think it was probably bigger for him. But definitely a scrappy win by Chris for a team that's been putting up a lot of numbers. Not a pretty win for him. Gladly, he'll take it. It actually came down to like the fourth quarter for Evan Ingram to catch one ball. Then ended up going for a touchdown that made the matchup look not as close as it was, but he was losing at one point. I think Chris showed some chinks in his armor as well. Although he was low record, he was a dominant force, I think top three in points. So they definitely showed that he's beatable this week. Big performance by his defense helped him out. DK Metcalf, obviously helped him out as well. So still has his heavy hitters, but I think he showed some chinks in his armor. As for Luke, things goes from bad to worse. He loses Aaron Rodgers now. I think he has DeAndre Swift on bye this week. So I'm playing him. So obviously I'm going to reap the benefits of that. And hopefully I could take him out because he should be. Should be a victory for me. But, you know, we've seen him upset. I think he beat Weezer this year. So he could upset anyone. But I think it's kind of getting late early for him.
I'm putting this on Luke, and it's not just about the draft and all the other fucking crazy, stupid decisions he's made. But to me, it's how do you not start Cole Beasley? That's number one. Number two for me is I would even consider starting AJ Green every week at this point with this team. I know Jerry Jeudy just got back, but I'm not going to trust Jerry Jeudy off injury with that shitty team.
Yeah,
and offense, I definitely don't trust Miles Sanders. I mean, I don't mind the Emmanuel Sanders start, and he put up a dud, which kind of sucks. He didn't get hurt, right? He just didn't catch anything. Yeah, he had four targets. I mean, that's bad, but I just don't see how you're starting Cole Beasley over, like, Emmanuel Sanders over Cole Beasley, for example. I think this is on Luke, personally. I mean, I'm just going to call it what it is. So, and, yeah, I mean, there's nothing else. I mean, Chris put his best players in. Nothing he could do there. Devontae Parker's been stepping up, though, but I can understand not trusting him. But he's got a great lineup, so.
Yeah, I'm scared of Chris's team. I'm happy I beat him and played him already, so I don't have to deal with him again. Because he has heavy hitters, but didn't hit this week.
His weakest spot is tight end with Waller out, but obviously Ingram's the reason he ended up winning anyway.
Yeah.
So, nice stream. Well done. And Luke, you're a fucking idiot at this point. Please trade me Pittman before it's over for you. Or give Dylan Pittman back.
Yeah, I'll take him back. It seems like since I dumped him off, I know people were questioning the Pittman for Ridley, you included. But Pittman's been performing at a wide receiver one level And I mean, Ridley was doing okay during the season anyways, not like he was doing bad. He was doing like 15 points a week. I think Pittman dropped like 30 this week, dropped like 20 something the week before. So
he looked like a true top three receiver this week.
Yeah, that's kind of why I drafted him.
Not even just the touchdowns.
Got him in another league too, kind of late. He's one of those guys that kind of always has the talent, but it'll take a little while to emerge. I think he's starting to do that. So, and he's playing the Jets this week.
My concern was the touchdowns. Like I told you, if this guy can start getting in the end zone, he's going to be – he can be a lethal player.
He is playing the Jets this week, so I got to watch out for that because I'm going against Luke. He's playing the Jets tomorrow night. Week. Yeah, so hopefully I don't start in a hole down 30-0 already from Michael Pittman.
Well, your silver lining is it's Thursday night, so I think you might be okay just because of shit show. You just don't know where you're getting a Thursday night. Or it could just completely fuck you, yeah. So that's definitely one of the big things to look at tomorrow. Pittman. I'd like to say Michael Carter, but you know, somebody's not gonna start him. You know, not too much to look forward to in that Thursday night matchup, but that's definitely one of the things we're looking at. So moving on, that's all the matchups we talked about. The two big matchups coming up next week. Obviously the big one. Who do you think's gonna win? Big, do you have anything to touch on before we move into these crazy news? We're just gonna call it crazy news of the week.
No, I just want to talk, like, you guys already said it. Chris has a really good team. Honestly, I just feel like he's getting unlucky. We all see Chris puts up, you know, hella points each week, but, you know, the team he plays just always puts up, you know, that much more than him. Chris could put up 150, and the team he'll play puts up 160, and it's just unfortunate. But Chris isn't out yet, and I wouldn't count him out. He's definitely going to make a run, and kind of happy for him since, you know, he lost the league last year. So I'm pushing for him to make the playoffs.
Yeah, but we alluded to last week that – go ahead.
Little Luke fucking hit me in Nick up like we were trying to trade, and he asked for Jonathan Taylor back like we were just going to give it to him.
My question, guys, is did he even realize who we had or who we had acquired to, you know? I think he forgets. Bro, I mean, if you look at his roster, all the guys we gave him, how many does he even have on his team still?
So. It's bad, dude.
Question to the public and for you too. Is it a win for Luke if he makes it out of the season not doing loser punishment? Is that a win for Luke?
Oh, yes.
I think it is.
At this point, absolutely at this point.
I think win. For him, it's like, you know how people say championship or bust? I think on like the downside, it's like loser punishment or not bust. Like anything besides that is a hit for him, honestly.
Yeah.
So what I was saying and what I was trying to text him, like, you know how kind of people start, you watch out your bye week, so you kind of try to trade for guys that already had their byes. So, like, if you need a win, like this week, like, I don't have Terry, so I traded for someone like Thielen. Like, for him, it almost doesn't matter now. Just try to build the best squad you can for the loser punishment playoffs. If there's anyone he could pick up, there's any waiver he has possibly left, which I don't think he has, anyone he could trade with, I think he should do it. I'm not even saying it because
his team looks solid though right now. I mean, if he plays the right people and whatever, shouldn't do the loser punishment for this squad that he has with all the people we've
given him. Put all his waiver budget on like the fucking first week.
Yeah, he did put it all on Eli Mitchell, and now he dropped Mitchell, and he's an RB1 for Tuchidane.
Yeah, that's right.
He wasn't patient enough with them, and if you're gonna put that much money, you better be patient with a guy like that.
Yeah, dude, that was like the worst move I've ever seen in fantasy history.
So I'm gonna read you guys. Interesting stat here. Luke Liguori, 11 less points than Big. Luke Liguori, more points than Baby Sal, more points than Weezer, more points than Tooch, more points than Cast. So that shows you that his team is not as bad as the record says. I think if we look at – can we look at points against? I think he has the most. If you just go to the
– I can here for some – weird reason on here. I can't figure it out.
Yeah, it says right there. You're there.
Oh. You're there.
I think he has the most. 1-1-5-2.
Yeah, yes, one, let me filter it though. Yeah.
No, it's all right. You see it. If you just look at the numbers, 1-1-5-2, the bottom one. He has the most. He has the most points against out of anybody. That's his points for. You got to go to his points against. That's his points against. So he has the most points against in the entire league. So not to say that he hasn't fucked himself and he's made stupid decisions, which he definitely has. But statistically, he's had the hardest schedule. You can't debate it. The numbers are right there. He's had the hardest schedule out of anybody. So that just goes to show that if his team's on, he could beat some of these top teams. I'm playing him this week. I don't think it's going to be an easy win by any means. I mean, on paper it should be, but it never is.
You know why he's so fucked up? Look at his waiver budget. He has it's not about not having any left. He has a dollar left. How do you end up with a dollar left? How'd you fuck your budget up to the point where you didn't spend the other dollar?
He has a dollar left just in case he's saving it just for something. He also has, wow, 17 moves. If you look at the moves, look at Christian McCaffrey, 46 moves. That's a manager right there. I love to see that. That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm surprised some of us have passed you this year, Dill. But you've also made a lot of trades. So they don't really count those. Or do they count those as moves? They should count those as moves.
They might. I don't know if they count or not. Yeah, the budgets are
getting low. Bubbles and games is kind of low in the moves this year. Is it just because it's a colon thing still? Is that part of it? Because it's hard to make moves with the second owner?
Well, they also have no budget left. So
we wasted our budget this week on McNichols.
Yeah, but I mean they've made like key moves that didn't even require budget. Like I'm pretty sure Totolo picked up Agnew for free.
Yeah, exactly.
So
we put in the waivers, but we lost a lot of waivers. So I don't know if that counts on moves or not, but we have put in waivers, but we lost them because we didn't really put that much budget on them. We were saving it for a time like, you know, someone like McNichols came on the waivers and running back one gets hurt or something.
Yeah,
like
big time running back goes down. Also, you guys have a pretty deep bench.
Yeah.
So it's like you didn't really need to, which is a good thing. Obviously, you drafted well and you guys made good trades. So kind of worked out. Like, I mean, sometimes if your team's rolling, you don't need to make pickups.
Yeah, that's like me and Nick do whatever.
Look at Junior.
Both take a look at the waivers and
see Junior's team is almost picture perfect. So it's like, I hate to say it, but he doesn't really need to make moves. Like, who does he need to pick up? That's going to be
better. Spend any money, make no moves.
Who is he going to pick up that's better than the people he's starting right now? I mean, yeah, McNichols is a good pickup.
He should be making moves because of his tep and like if he starts losing any of these starters, but.
Yeah,
he doesn't need to. He's lazy. He's got his team. So until, I just want to see what happens. I want to see how Junior deals with adversity. We all have to go through it, and it is only week 8. He's going to have some adversity. Like, let's be honest. Obviously, luck plays a factor, but the way this league is going and the stuff we're about to get into, there's no way Junior's going to get scotch free for the next 9 more weeks. There's no way.
Him and Joey,
he's going to have to make moves. Joey has a bench though. Joey might have the best bench in the league, so at least he'll be. Which kind of sucks to say, but Joey might actually be okay. And Junior's fucked when he starts getting some injuries.
So it's I think
he does have Fab. So
this is the part that I've been waiting for, and most people probably been waiting for the huge list of crazy shit that happened this week. If you want to take us through it, baby Sal.
Yeah, I don't even know where to start, but I'm gonna start right here with the good old Aaron Rodgers. Aaron Rodgers has COVID and Davante Adams is back. So that's the big news. And so is Alan Lazard.
Well, he's not back yet. He's not back yet. He's supposed to return to practice on Thursday. Alan Lazard, positive for COVID. Couple other players, I think. It hit the Adams last week, and I guess it's kind of making its way through the Packers locker room, which is what COVID does. Which is rough for them.
Did Aaron Rodgers lie about getting vaccinated? Is that what I heard correctly?
So it was weird. He said he didn't get vaccinated, but he said something like, "I'm immune." He said some weird thing, like,
Maybe he claimed he had the antibodies.
Yeah. It was a weird situation, but no, he's not actually vaccinated, so he's out for, I guess, 10 days. It is the protocol.
Yep.
He is not playing Sunday. That's the key.
So COVID-wise,
that's COVID news. We have Odell Beckham's father decided to release an 11-minute montage about his not getting targeted to Baker Mayfield.
Of him being wide open and Baker not hitting him. So I think he doesn't want to play football anymore. He doesn't want to play for them. He didn't show up to practice, I think.
Well, the report is that Browns have excused him from practice and basically from the team. So they told the players that basically he's not playing with us. He's on the team, but he's not on the team.
So you got that. You got Calvin Ridley, who's walking away from football for God knows how long. Michael Thomas is done for the season, as if he ever played anyways. What else am I missing here? A couple. Most of these guys
Derrick
are on my
Henry
fucking
obviously
team.
Talked about foot season ending foot surgery. Yeah, obviously the big guys.
McCaffrey might be coming back. And then I don't know. I know the Henry Ruggs thing.
Yep.
As everyone knows, he's going to jail probably for the rest of his life or a long time. So that does.
Let's touch on that one. Let's touch on the.
As if the fucking Raiders organization doesn't need any more drama to brought to them.
Yeah, but we are human, and we should. I mean, you know, this is a sad situation. So number one, I just want to make sure we shout out the family and that our prayers and everything is with them. Number one, also with Henry Ruggs, because I mean, he made a terrible decision and he's got to be accountable for it. But I don't think he got behind the wheel with intention to hurt anybody. I obviously, it was a terrible decision, and that's why you shouldn't do it. But the guy's career is over, basically. He's going to – I think the minimum sentence is 2 years.
His life is over, dude. He's going –
His life is pretty much over, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he's going away for vehicular manslaughter.
Not good.
Vehicular manslaughter, DUI, firearm. I mean, he'll never play again.
It's everything.
He'll be in jail definitely probably for a while. But I guess for a fantasy perspective, it opens some things up for the Raiders offense, whatever is remaining for it. Does that? I think he was one of their better receivers. I think Waller's still probably their best pass catcher. We could probably go with a Hunter Renfrow or a Bryan Edwards, someone like that, to fill in another role. And I don't know if the run
Zay
game
Jones
picks
a step up,
up
maybe.
I don't know if the run game picks up at all with Josh Jacobs or Kenyon Drake or the little committee they got going there. But yeah, man, I don't really know what else to say with this, but for a fantasy perspective, that's probably what people need to know.
Yeah. I think my lesson is to get from it is just make a call. I mean, you have all the resources, especially as an NFL player, but I mean, we all do. It's 2021. So call a friend, call an Uber. Just, you know, just don't get behind the wheel. Try to hold each other accountable as well. Just never good. You know, life is what is, ends up in result is someone's life. So, and I don't know how he's not dead. So 156 miles per hour, dude. What do you think, Pig?
I just don't get, like, people would kill to be in these guys' situation with all the money that they have and, like, set for life, and you could just go do something so stupid like that. Like, you know you're drinking, bro. Why are you getting in a car and driving? Like, I don't care if you had 2, 3, 4 drinks. Like, you're not drunk. You still have alcohol in your system, dude, and, like, going 156 miles an hour. Like, come on, dude. That it's just reckless. It's careless, and I really don't even know what to say because I just hate to see – that should happen, especially when you're set up for life and people would die to be in your position and you blow it all away because some one reckless thing you do. It's a shame.
Waste
really
someone's life.
And you know I loved Henry Ruggs, bro. He's one of my favorite, you know, people that were drafted in the last few years. I loved him at Bama. So it's just it's frustrating to see that shit. It really is.
Yeah, man. Well, again, prayers are out to the family and let's try to learn from it. And, you know, wish him the best for whatever he has to go through. I guess the other big news too, before we close this out, is just all the, this is a huge waiver week and not just waivers, just transactions in general. So not just fad budget, but just pick up his ads and a lot of things going on between everything we talked about and what obviously the buys are continuing to pour in. So a lot of things going on and I'm not going to go through them all because it's like 100 this week, but definitely something to look into, and it's just interesting to see all these teams. Each team is really starting to change and mold and shift this in the middle of the season. So my entire bench is different this week. So a lot of different things going on. I know everyone's making moves. So you guys have any key things you want to point out or anything you want to say?
We got through most of it.
Yeah, I think we did a good job.
Yeah, for sure. It's always good. Nice to have Big on. Have Big on it when he has a huge winning record sitting in fourth place.
Yeah, I mean, we had his partner on last week.
He did a great job.
Would have been nice to have them both at the same time, but it's kind of good that we got two different insights, and they both kind of said the same thing. I think they're both probably the most dynamic duo that we've had so far in terms of co-owners, just by record-wise and how they're performing and just kind of the depth of the roster. So I only see them trending up from here.
let's hope for a commissioner win back to back, and maybe we can get him on next week. Yeah, off another big win.
Yeah, I know he said that he'd be looking to come on next week. So there's a lot, one last look at the matchups. I want to see any other sleeper matchups we got this week.
Oh, it might be that one itself. Oh no, because how does he deal with the loss of Henry? I mean, might be interesting.
And no Bucks.
Yeah, that's gonna be tough for him, man.
Yeah,
kind of writing him off.
I mean, a couple kind of.
Chris might be able to pull a nice upset off this week with the buys.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, if Luke drops another one, it kind of takes a lot of the wind out of his sails because he was rolling. If he drops another one, that'd actually be good for me. I could slide into maybe the 3-4 spot. But
all eyes are going to be on the Joey matchup. So.
Yeah. Yeah, Joe-Koempel versus Joe-Koempel.
Do they have anybody tomorrow?
Yep,
Indy Dipping.
Yeah, if Joey decides he wants to play Michael Carter, then yeah.
Yeah, that's the one I was thinking of. Yep, but I don't think he's going to unless he does listen to every podcast. I got to give him credit there. He does love the podcast and everything, the power rankings, everything we put out. So, rest is on Joey. I don't think he needs any help. He knows what he's doing. He's back to back and on his way to number 3. So, that's it, guys. Let's keep this rolling. Keep growing and having fun. And stay safe. Make good decisions and tell someone you love them.
This was a good one, boys. Look forward to next week. Keep eye out for maybe the commish.
Thank you for having me.
Good luck this week.
Love you, boys.
Yeah.